You can use M2L by starting a Google Chrome browser and going to www.m2l.sony.net/portal. That will bring you to the M2L logon page. When you arrive at the logon page, you can sign in with either a Sony account or a professional account. With a Sony account, there is a free trial of 5 hours available for any user. In order to create an account for either a Sony or professional account, click on the sign in button then select create account. Your language, enter your date of birth, agree to the terms of service, review them if need be, and press continue. Enter your email address and create your own private password. You will need to verify your email address by clicking on the link sent to your email address. Once done, you can select already verified. Agree to the licensing terms and a privacy policy and proceed to the switcher resources themselves. That brings you to the dashboard page for M2L. When using a Sony account, the first thing you'll see is the opportunity to choose your account type. There is a free trial available, which can be accessed by selecting Buy Now. There are a variety of plans available, including a free trial, which determine the number of hours per month you anticipate to use, and the number of months you wish to use them for. The pricing reduces the more hours are used. There is no knowledge of cloud resources or technologies required for the use of M2L. In this case, we'll select the free trial and configure our first event. Once chosen, I can go back to my account manager. Then I can go back to my dashboard and see that I've got no available events. If I press the plus key, I get the opportunity to create my first event. I can create a group name which will enable me to create lists of people to take part in my event. In this case, I'm only allowed to use the EU West 1 Amazon data center. By pressing apply, those details are saved to the event. Then the newly created event can be seen in the event list. If I select the event and wait for the initialization process to complete, I can then manage the details of the event. I can give the name an event subdomain, which is unique to the event and can be used for a human readable connection later on between some Sony cameras and M2L. Pressing apply saves that setting to the event itself. Once saved, I can go back to the dashboard and see my event ready to go. The settings of the event can be configured here. File Manager allows you to upload media to be used in your event. For stills and clips alike, select Upload to choose from your local hard drive which media you desire to upload into the system. The clip and still types are available from the help guide, which is available on the screen by selecting Help Guide to the right. Back on the File Manager page also allows the connection to an external graphics system. One of the HTML5 graphics engines that integrates with M2L is Singular Live, and this URL is the output URL from Singular Live, which you paste into this location and select Apply. Then the Start button at the bottom is used to begin the event once you're ready. Let's begin with the system settings. The system settings screen shows you inputs at the top, outputs in the middle, and additional audio inputs. At the very bottom of the screen is the choice of live operation proxy, which should be determined by the available bandwidth from the location you're operating M2L from. If there is a restricted bandwidth available, then low should be selected. Otherwise, choose middle or high, depending on your experience. An input can be configured by selecting it from the list. We can change the names of inputs to what we feel is appropriate. In this case, I'm using a cameraman's name. I also have access to the encoding types or the stream source types. These could be Sony cameras. They could be the XDCam Pocket companion application, which is available for iOS or Android phones. It could be SRT encoded streams, RTMP or RTMPS encoded streams. In this case, we'll start with XDCam Pocket. Because M2L is the master of this relationship, M2L can tell XDCam Pocket at which video bitrate to encode. This can be changed to suit the bandwidth available at that camera source. If it's the mobile phone itself creating the video and audio over a telecoms network, 3G, 4G, or perhaps 5G, this video data rate can be modified appropriately. The buffer is to allow for latencies in the network. That will be determined by network conditions on the day of the event. The audio codec is always AAC with M2L, and in this case, XDCam Pocket, the audio frequency is always 48 kHz. I have the opportunity to select from a variety of frame rates. I have different raster sizes available, 1280 by 720 or 1920 by 1080, and different frame rates available, 50p, 25p. The encoder type in XDCam Pocket is always high efficiency video codec H.265. In this case, we're going to choose a 1920 1080 25p encoding type. Once configured, I can press apply and those settings are stored in the event. The device ID is created once that XDCAM Pocket device connects to M2L. These device IDs can be manipulated to determine which source is on which input of the switcher. Configuring input 2, I can choose a different source type. I'll call this main camera. I'll choose an SRT encoding type and look at the choices that are now available. In the SRT standard, H.264 AVC is supported and H.265 HEVC is supported with M2L. In this particular case, I'm going to choose H.264 AVC at 1920, 1080 and 25p. The effort should be to make sure that the video formats are consistent throughout the number of inputs that are required. Again, the buffer setting takes care of video latencies. The audio codec is AAC, and I can choose the audio sampling frequency determined by the encoder. So make sure these are consistent between the encoder and M2L. To make the connection with an SRT source, first enter an appropriate stream key. Once created, selecting Apply will create the connection information. This URL should be copied and entered into the SRT encoder along with the stream key to ensure that there is a connection between source and destination and relevant security in place. Selecting the next input allows me to add sources as I like. Again, a different streaming type, but let's try to be consistent in our raster size and frame rate. The audio codec is determined by M2L. The audio frequency is consistent with the encoder. And again, a stream key is required to be entered in M2L, the apply button pressed, and the target URL for the encoder created that could be copied and entered into the encoder itself along with the stream key. There's two relevant items to notice in the URLs given by M2L. The first is the use of the human readable event subdomain that you created in the details tab. That can be used to connect with some Sony cameras. And then secondly, the port number 40002, the 2 refers directly to the camera input number. And these URLs can be manipulated should you wish to in your event determine which encoders are coming into your switcher on which inputs. On the output side, by selecting the output, I have the opportunity to configure the output. In a similar way to the inputs, I can select a streaming type. I can select a video format. And notice there are interlaced outputs available from M2L. And here I'm going to use the same output type as our input type. This is not necessary. I could use 50i or another output destination. The output destination may be another part of the world where a different frequency is used, such as 60p or 5994. The video data rate should be determined by the available bandwidth of the network between the cloud and your target destination. This can be varied to suit the conditions. The buffer takes care of network latencies. The audio codec is AAC, and the audio frequency would be determined by the target destination. The connection information is determined by the target destination. The address host information should be provided from Facebook Live or YouTube, or whatever system you're using as a target destination, along with its stream key, which will be used for securitization. Selecting apply saves that information to the output configuration. A function is available on M2L for auto digest. However, one needs to be careful if you want to use this function that the audio frequency is set to 44.1. Additional audio inputs can be configured in a very similar way. The encoding type is only SRT. The name could be appropriate. The buffering should be managed similarly to take care of network latencies, and the audio frequency should match the incoming stream type. Again, create your stream key. Select apply, and your address host will be given. Notice the port type are 25, 26, and 27. Once your inputs, outputs, microphone, and proxy quality is selected, one can return to the dashboard. Once configured and material loaded, the event could be started by pressing the start button. You can see the event is starting from the status indication. Once the M2L event is up and running, and you can have multiple events running simultaneously on the same account, two more buttons appear. Live operation to go and see the switch in operation, and streaming monitor. Streaming monitor allows you to see the incoming streams and check their quality and data rates. Once the event's completed, the stop button allows the event to be stopped and should be remembered at the event at the end of each event in order to avoid wasting account time hours, and confirm. The event will take a few minutes to stop. In normal operation, outside of the trial, then all of your media and settings are then saved by the Sony cloud account for your next usage. So no media recordings or anything are lost, and this event can be restarted as and when you so desire.